Hi, my name is Michael Niksic. I'm also known as the Food Mercenary. Today, we are going to get into serious chili. The chili I'm going to show you to make in this DVD is going to blow your doors off. You show up at the county fair with these recipes, they're going to wonder where you came up with it. It's going to be the coolest stuff. We're going to overcome myths in cooking, and we're going to show you some really great techniques. And in particular, we're going to get into something that's called compound cooking. Compound cooking is taking various items that are made separately and bringing them together to make something that's extraordinary. So what we're going to do is we're going to get into everything starting right now. We're going to cut up a green bell pepper now, and we're going to do it unlike a lot of other people do. They show you very complicated ways to do this. And taking care of a bell pepper and cutting it up and dicing it should be a very easy task. So we're going to make it easy. What we're going to do is we're going to take it, and we're going to cut right down the sides of it, just like this, one side at a time. Just lay it down, and we're going to cut this off, and then we're going to cut the bottom off. Then we have all the rest of it that we don't need in one piece, and we have five even flat segments here, and we have a clean cutting board. So what we're going to do is we're going to open our drawer, get rid of it, and now we're ready to dice. Clean cutting board, flat pieces, easy to dice. Doesn't get faster than that. What we're going to do is even cuts. And again, like so. We're cutting up vegetables for chili, so we want them a little bit on the hearty side. So we're going to go to the half-inch square side, which is mostly called, in French, a brunoise. And there you go. Easy enough. Whenever you're cleaning your cutting board, remember, use the back of the knife. I like this. It doesn't dull your blade. All right. Now, if you're going to slice a mushroom, you always want to take, slice one end off first, and then roll it over to the flat side. It's always easier to cut up anything, no matter what it is, with the flat side down. It's very difficult to cut things that are round. They move. If they move, you're using a sharp knife, it's easy to draw blood. You don't want to do that. So, like so, and then roll it over. Notice I keep the edge of the knife down so there's the minimum amount of noise. You see any woodpeckers in the kitchen? You don't want that. That's not professional. In professional kitchens, you don't see that. It's not necessary and it's not needed. Extra noise in the kitchen, that's up to the chef to be yelling at everybody, so you want to make sure you can hear them. And like so. Nice even cuts. Dicing an onion. First thing you want to do, cut off the end. Now when you cut off the end, make sure that the entire stem is gone. The stem is wood. You can break your tooth on wood. You do not want that part. You're not saving money. Get rid of it. Flip it over. Take care of the other top. Split it in half. Again, always keep your cutting boards clear and clean. Get rid of this outside peel and layers. This is woody. This is harsh. You don't want that in your chili or your soups. And again, likewise, peel that outside layer off. Make sure you get rid of it. Nice clean onions, good flavor, nice and sweet. That's what you want to dice with. Whenever you're cutting anything, always make sure flat side down so you've got an easy surface to cut with and it doesn't move on you. You're going to take your knife, you're going to run it across the onion a couple of times. You're not going to cut all the way through, but you're going to slice just short of the end, just like this, so that there's just enough onion holding it together for you. Then, once you've got a couple of slices this way to even it out, you're going to come back and go vertically through the onion. Now you've got even cuts this way and even cuts this way, and you'll get yourself an even dice. Last piece that's holding everything together, we dice it up, and we're all done. I'm going to cut once, and we're going to cut twice. Notice I didn't cut all the way through, it's still held together. And again, we're going to slice it almost to the end, keeping your fingers clear. And get the edge there. And then we come back, and again, even cut all the way to the end. Okay, now we're ready to start our Cajun rice. Our pan is getting hot, and what we're going to do is we're going to add our oil first. We're using corn oil. We don't need much because we're using non-stick pans. Start off with our corn oil, make sure that this covers the bottom of it. And we're going to add our onions first. always add the onions away from you to prevent splattering. You don't want to be splattered. Give them a little bit of a stir. Move them around a bit. There's no need to pick up the onion, the skillet, and do this when you're using a flat surface and an induction plate. Okay? Next, after the onions have got a start, we're going to add our poblano peppers. Now, we don't have to wait too long for the onions because the poblano peppers, the walls on them are a little thin and not like green bell peppers. They're not as thick and they're not quite as dense. So we can actually add them almost at the exact same time without much of an issue. When we want our onions to cook until they're translucent, we want our poblano peppers likewise to cook more nice and all the way through, thoroughly done. We'll speed up the process, we'll put our lid on, and we'll be back to that in just a second. Okay, now we've got our onions and our peppers started, and we've got some nice brown color to them to give them that little bit of the Cajun bite. You only need to add your garlic at the very end. Get it hot in the oil. That'll bring the flavor of the garlic out. You don't need to do much more than that. And if you were here, you'd be able to smell that garlic flavor. It's all over the place already. Now what we're going to do is we're going to add our water. We heated it up to speed things along. And we're going to add our seasonings that are already measured out. So we make this a nice quick segment. And we're going to add our tomato paste. And we're going to add a half a can. And we're going to stir this in. Now we've got our tomato paste added, our vegetables are in here and they're all sauteed, and we've got our seasonings added to the broth. And this is about to come to a boil. As soon as this comes to a boil, we're going to add our rice, which is literally happening right now. Now here's the mistake that most people make when they're doing rice pilafs. In restaurants, we never boil our rice on a stovetop for two reasons. One, we don't generally have the space to do that. And number two, when you boil your rice, the starch comes out of the rice. This is what makes it into a sticky, gooey mess. We do not want that boiling action where the water is simmering and moving around. So what we're going to do is we're going to add the rice now that it's come to a boil. And we're going to just stir it gently so it's moved around, so all the seasonings are moved around and they're nice and consistent. And they're throughout the entire broth along with the rice itself. And this is going to come to literally a simmer within seconds. You can see this happening already. Now, as soon as this starts to simmer just a little bit more, what we're going to do is we're going to put a lid on this. We're going to take the whole thing, we're going to put it right in the oven. And we're going to bake it until all the juices are gone. When all the juices are gone, it is done. Generally speaking, for this batch, it's going to be about 20 minutes at 375. Okay, now that we have it on the counter, always make sure that you're handling it with a dry towel, not a damp towel, not a pot holder. Pot holders are dirty and you can't clean them. Use a towel. It covers your hand. Get anything wet on it, you spill on it, you can get rid of it right away and save your hand a bad burn. So now what we're going to do is we're going to position this, open up the lid. Oh, look at that. And we give it a stir. And look at this. Just like that, we have a nice batch of Cajun rice. All those little seasonings and whatnot that came up to the top, we just stir it right back in. And you can see how the rice is nice and separated. It's not stuck in lumps and it breaks apart. And it's cooked and all the moisture is gone. Perfect. Common mistake making meat chili. Most of the people that make meat chilies, they take the ground beef and they put it in the pot to cook it. This is a big mistake. You can't brown the meat like that. You end up steaming it because there's not enough heat being generated in the pot for all that ground beef. So the question is, how do you get that nice, rich, browned flavor on the beef? What we're gonna do is we're gonna roast it. We're gonna put it into a hot oven. We're gonna season it very lightly with just a little bit of sea salt. This will help enhance the actual browning and enhance the flavor that's gonna be brought into it by browning. We're gonna take it, we're gonna slide it into the oven. Now we're using a baking pan here with a raised edge and we're putting it on baking paper. This makes it easier to get out. And also too, since we're using an aluminum pan, we don't want the aluminum to actually touch our food because we don't like aluminum touching our food. Now what will happen is ground beef will render in the oven. This is 85% lean, but we still don't want that extra fat going into our chili. So what we're going to do is we're going to put this in the oven, we're going to brown it really nice, render the fat out, render the excess juices that we don't want in here, the extra blood and whatnot, roast it nice and brown, and then we're going to take it out and we're going to crumble it all up. So we're all set and ready to rock and roll for this part of our making the meat chili. And it's that easy. Now, ovens vary in temperature. We're doing this at 375. Depending on how your oven works and how much meat that you're going to make for your chili is depending on how long it's going to roast. Remember, it's really, really difficult to overcook it because, in essence, we're doing it well done to begin with. And then it's going to simmer again in the chili. So don't worry about overcooking it. What we're more concerned about is getting a nice, even brown color. Notice that all the fat is now off the meat. Extra blood, we've got a nice brown texture to it. We can take this and we can chop it up into chunks. We're going to have a heartier, richer chili by roasting off the beef like this. It gets rid of all these impurities, all the stuff that you see bleeding off of here. This is the stuff we don't want in the chili. This is the stuff that gives it an aftertaste. We want our chili to be really hearty and cool and really, really tasty. And this is what we want. Now, if you want your chili meat to be a little bit browner, what you can do is you can break it up like I'm doing right now. You can take it, you can flip it over. And we're gonna take this and we're gonna pop it back into the oven for a few minutes. We're gonna brown the other side off. So you see all this part here that was attached to the baking paper? It's not as brown as what was on the top that was exposed to the oven heat. So we're gonna take it and flip it over and we'll get the other side. You notice how big these chunks are? Well, when you take your meat and you cook it in a pot, the ground beef will fall apart and get all crumbly and mealy. Here, cooking it like this, the ground beef stays together in bigger pieces. And then even when you break it apart and put it into the chili, it's still going to be a nice, hearty, chunky pieces. So that when you're having chili, you're having chili. Now we're ready to start the meat chili. We've already roasted off the meat, we got it nice and brown, and we've broken it up into small pieces, which is really easy to do. Just let it cool off and break it up with your hands. You see some of the pieces are larger, some of the pieces are smaller. That's okay. During the cooking process and the serving process, that just adds to it. Bigger pieces, smaller pieces. No big deal at all. Over here, we have our red beans already ready to rock and roll. We already have this recipe. We've gone over that before. We're going to start the cooking process. Whenever you're cooking your vegetables, you always start heaviest or hardest vegetable first. In this case, it's celery. We're going to begin the cooking process with our celery. We're going to give it a head start. After it gets a couple of seconds in here, we're going to add our bell peppers and our onions. We're going to give them a nice start. After they are nicely translucent, then we're going to add our garlic last. You only want to heat it up for just a couple of moments. And then we add all the rest of our ingredients. Our diced tomatoes, our tomato juice, our tomato paste. Also, too, our cooked beans and our ground beef. And we also have our seasoning stand, which are already ready to rock and roll, already pre-measured, so that we can just knock this out. Now, sometimes you'll see some recipes that call for everything to be made in the same pot. That's a bad method. Whenever you're cooking anything, like it's chili, like this, you shouldn't be doing necessarily everything in the same pot. Because what it does is you end up overloading the pot. If you overload the pot with vegetables, what happens is you no longer saute them. You steam them because there's not enough heat and not enough room in the pan to saute them properly. As a result, the juices bleed out of the vegetables, the liquid forms in the bottom of the pan, and it begins to boil from the heat. And you're no longer sauteing, you're now boiling. And that's why there's such a big difference between a boiled onion and a sauteed onion. Boiled onions don't taste very good. Sauteed onions are sweeter and they're caramelized. So you want to apply the same method the food that you're cooking inside your pan. So when you're sauteing, always make sure that there's plenty of room to actually cook the vegetables or whatever it is in the pan. Don't overload your pans. Huge cooking method problem. Problematic with many chefs as well too. They're in a hurry, time constraints, too much to do at the same time. They get sloppy, they put too much in the pan. Instead of sauteing the products, they end up boiling them. And that's why a lot of times when you go into restaurants and you order soup, the soup isn't quite what you thought it would be, usually because of poor cooking methods. Now while we're doing that, it's almost time already for our onions. We've got a nice hot skillet here to work with. We're going to add our onions. We're going to give our onions about a minute and a half. And then we're going to add our mushrooms. add the rest of our products. We're going to start with the tomato juice. And we're going to add our seasonings. And we're going to add our other tomato products, our diced tomatoes. And we're going to add our tomato paste. Nothing like a good can of fresh tomato paste. Yum, yum. This is just like Mommy used to make. That's why Dad left home. Okay. We're going to stir this up a bit, and we're going to add our meat last. And we're going to add our beans after that. Now remember, our recipe of red beans is highly seasoned, so that's going to add a big charge of flavor into this, on top of all the seasonings that we're really using. So yes, you can use canned beans for this. You can use kidney beans, things of that nature, right out of the can. They're not going to have the same amount of flavor and depth of flavor for the chili itself. See how nice and thick that is? No thickening agents. There's no need for a roux or anything like that. No cornstarch necessary. We got these nice, rich beans. We need to use 12 ounces, so we're going to measure it out to make sure that we have enough. And actually, we're going to add just a little bit more because we like beans, not chili. Here we go. And we'll give it a little stir. Make sure that we incorporate that nicely. But remember, if you like beans, you can always add more beans. Remember, the bean recipe, highly seasoned, not going to alter it. Once you get this recipe, if you want to play with it, make it hotter, make it sweeter, whatever the case may be, go for it. Because now, at this point in time, it's your recipe, and you can play with it any way you wish. Now we're going to add our beef, and you can see all these big chunks going in there, so this is going to be a nice, hearty meal. This is great for a summer day at the ballpark, for tailgating, for a football game. Excellent stuff, nice and hearty. In my book, chili should be eaten with a fork, not a spoon. There we go. Oh yeah, now that's a chili. You have all your ingredients in the chili. All you have to do is bring it to a nice boil, and you are done. All the seasonings will bleed through very, very clearly and efficiently. You don't have to cook it for hours and hours on end. All that does is blows away the vegetables. It gives anything that's in there a chance to get nice and bitter. There's no need to cook chili for hours and hours. Chili should be quick and to the point. Okay? We're done. Meat chili is ready to rock and roll. And we're on to the next one. All right. Now what we're going to do is we're going to make a meat eater's vegetarian chili. Vegetarian chili, usually to meat eaters, is like, ugh! But you got to be careful. Be nice to vegetarians. Remember, they're just poor hunters. We gotta be cool vegetarians. Vegetarians out there, this is a great chili. This is not like the rest of the chilies that are out there. This one is really like a meat eater's chili. When I've sold this in the past at other restaurants in my career as a chef, the meat eaters get into this chili because it's nice and hearty, it's rich, very, very low cholesterol, and it's really, really healthy. It's got a lot of really fresh ingredients in it, a very, very high nutritional content, lots of roughage, good for you all the way around. Okay, first thing that we're going to do, we're going to start off like we always do. We preheat our pan, and we're going to start off using olive oil. We're going to drizzle just enough to coat the bottom of the pan. And once again, we're going to make sure we don't overload our pan. We're going to start off this chili with our celery, which is the hardest of the vegetables that we have. Common mistake making meat chili. Most of the people that make meat chilies, they take the ground beef and they put it in the pot to cook it. This is a big mistake. You can't brown the meat like that. You end up steaming it because there's not enough heat being generated in the pot for all that ground beef. So, the question is, how do you get that nice, rich, browned flavor on the beef? What we're gonna do is, we're gonna roast it. We're gonna put it into a hot oven. We're gonna season it very lightly with just a little bit of sea salt. This will help enhance the actual browning and enhance the flavor that's going to be brought into it by browning. We're going to take it, we're going to slide it into the oven. Now we're using a baking pan here with a raised edge, and we're putting that baking paper. This makes it easier to get out. And also too, since we're using an aluminum pan, we don't want the aluminum to actually touch our food, because we don't like aluminum touching our food. Now what will happen is, ground beef will render in the oven. This is 85% lean, but we still don't want that extra fat going into our chili. So what we're going to do is we're going to put this in the oven, we're going to brown it really nice, render the fat out, render the excess juices that we don't want in here, the extra blood and whatnot, roast it nice and brown, and then we're going to take it out and we're going to crumble it all up. So we're all set and ready to rock and roll for this part of our making the meat chili. And it's that easy. Now, ovens vary in temperature. We're doing this at 375. Depending on how your oven works and how much meat that you're going to make for your chili is depending on how long it's going to roast. Remember, it's really, really difficult to overcook it because, in essence, we're doing it well done to begin with. And then it's going to simmer again in the chili. So don't worry about overcooking it. What we're more concerned about is getting a nice, even brown color. Notice that all the fat is now off the meat. The extra blood, we've got a nice brown texture to it. We can take this and we can chop it up into chunks. We're going to have a heartier, richer chili by roasting off the beef like this. It gets rid of all these impurities, all the stuff that you see bleeding off of here. This is the stuff we don't want in the chili. This is the stuff that gives it an aftertaste. We want our chili to be really hearty and cool and really, really tasty. And this is what we want. Now, if you want your chili meat to be a little bit browner, what you can do is you can break it up like I'm doing right now. You can take it, you can flip it over. And we're going to take this and we're going to pop it back into the oven for a few minutes. We're going to brown the other side off. So you see all this part here that was attached to the baking paper? It's not as brown as what was on the top that was exposed to the oven heat. So we're going to take it and flip it over and we'll get the other side. You notice how big these chunks are? Well, when you take your meat and you cook it in a pot, the ground beef will fall apart and get all crumbly and mealy. Here, cooking it like this, the ground beef stays together in bigger pieces. And then even when you break it apart and put it into the chili, it's still going to be a nice, hearty, chunky pieces. So that when you're having chili, you're having chili! Now we're ready to start the meat chili. We've already roasted off the meat, we got it nice and brown, and we've broken it up into small pieces, which is really easy to do. Just let it cool off and break it up with your hands. You can see some of the pieces are larger, some of the pieces are smaller. That's okay during the cooking process and the serving process. That just adds to it. Bigger pieces, smaller pieces. No big deal at all. Over here, we have our red beans already ready to rock and roll. We already have this recipe. We've gone over that before. We're going to start the cooking process. Whenever you're cooking your vegetables, you always start heaviest or hardest vegetable first. In this case, it's celery. We're going to begin the cooking process with our celery. We're going to give it a head start. After it gets a couple of seconds in here, we're going to add our bell peppers and our onions. We're going to give them a nice start. After they are nicely translucent, then we're going to add our garlic last. You only want to heat it up for just a couple of moments. And then we add all the rest of our ingredients. Our diced tomatoes, our tomato juice, our tomato paste. Also, too, our cooked beans and our ground beef. And we also have our seasoning stand, which are already ready to rock and roll, already pre-measured, so we can just knock this out. Now, sometimes you'll see some recipes that call for everything to be made in the same pot. That's a bad method. Whenever you're cooking anything, like this chili, like this, you shouldn't be doing necessarily everything in the same pot. Because what it does is you end up overloading the pot. If you overload the pot with vegetables, what happens is you no longer saute them. You steam them because there's not enough heat and not enough room in the pan to saute them properly. As a result, the juices bleed out of the vegetables, the liquid forms in the bottom of the pan, and it begins to boil from the heat. And you're no longer sauteing, you're now boiling. And that's why there's such a big difference between a boiled onion and a sauteed onion. Boiled onions don't taste very good. Sauteed onions are sweeter and they're caramelized. So you want to apply the same method the food that you're cooking inside your pan. So when you're sauteing, always make sure that there's plenty of room to actually cook the vegetables or whatever it is in the pan. Don't overload your pans. Huge cooking method problem. Problematic with many chefs as well too. They're in a hurry, time constraints, too much to do at the same time. They get sloppy, they put too much in the pan. Instead of sauteing the products, they end up boiling them. And that's why a lot of times when you go into restaurants and you order soup, the soup isn't quite what you thought it would be, usually because of poor cooking methods. Now while we're doing that, it's almost time already for our onions. We've got a nice hot skillet here to work with. We're going to add our onions. We're going to give our onions about a minute and a half. And then we're going to add our mushrooms. Now we're going to add the rest of our products. We're going to start with the tomato juice. And we're going to add our seasonings. And we're going to add our other tomato products, our diced tomatoes. And we're going to add our tomato paste. Nothing like a good can of fresh tomato paste. Yum, yum. This is just like Mommy used to make. That's why Dad left home. Okay, we're going to stir this up a bit, and we're going to add our meat last. And we're going to add our beans after that. Now remember, our recipe of red beans is highly seasoned, so that's going to add a big charge of flavor into this, on top of all the seasonings that we're really using. So yes, you can use canned beans for this. You can use kidney beans, things of that nature, right out of the can. They're not going to have the same amount of flavor and depth of flavor for the chili itself. See how nice and thick that is? No thickening agents. There's no need for a roux or anything like that. No cornstarch necessary. We got these nice rich beans that we need to use. 12 ounces. So we're going to measure it out to make sure that we have enough. And actually, we're going to add just a little bit more because we like beans, not chili. Here we go. And we'll give it a little stir. Make sure that we incorporate that nicely. But remember, if you like beans, you can always add more beans. Remember, the bean recipe, highly seasoned, not going to alter it. Once you get this recipe, if you want to play with it, make it hotter, make it sweeter, whatever the case may be, go for it. Because now, at this point in time, it's your recipe, and you can play with it any way you wish. Now we're going to add our beef, and you can see all these big chunks going in there, so this is going to be a nice, hearty meal. This is great for a summer day at the ballpark, for tailgating, for a football game. Excellent stuff, nice and hearty. In my book, chili should be eaten with a fork, not a spoon. There we go. Oh yeah, now that's a chili. You have all your ingredients in the chili. All you have to do is bring it to a nice boil, and you are done. All the seasonings will bleed through very, very clearly and efficiently. You don't have to cook it for hours and hours on end. All that does is blows away the vegetables. It gives anything that's in there a chance to get nice and bitter. There's no need to cook chili for hours and hours. Chili should be cooking to the point. Okay? We're done. Meat chili is ready to rock and roll. And we're on to the next one. All right. Now what we're going to do is we're going to make a meat eater's vegetarian chili. Vegetarian chili, usually to meat eaters, is like, ugh! But you got to be careful. Be nice to vegetarians. Remember, they're just poor hunters. We gotta be cool vegetarians. Vegetarians out there, this is a great chili. This is not like the rest of the chilies that are out there. This one is really like a meat eater's chili. When I've sold this in the past at other restaurants in my career as a chef, the meat eaters get into this chili because it's nice and hearty, it's rich, very, very low cholesterol, and it's really, really healthy. It's got a lot of really fresh ingredients in it, a very, very high nutritional content, lots of roughage, good for you all the way around. Okay, first thing that we're going to do, we're going to start off like we always do. We preheat our pan, and we're going to start off using olive oil. We're going to drizzle just enough to coat the bottom of the pan. And once again, we're going to make sure we don't overload our pan. We're going to start off this chili with our celery, which is
the hardest of the vegetables that we have to use. And you stir them around a bit, give them a nice start, give them nice and hot. We're going to give them a head start for just a few seconds, because what we want is all the vegetables to be nice and crisp and al dente. That way, you get the most nutritional value out of it. And also, too, with them being harder and crisper, it's going to be a lot better for your roughage and basically digesting them and getting them out of your system. So what we don't want to do is we don't want to blow them away when we're sauteing them. We want to saute them just long enough to make it nice and caramelized and sweet. Give it a real nice flavor. Our celery's got just a few seconds of head lead weight on everything else, which is really cool because that's what we want. And we're going to add our next vegetable, which is going to be our bell peppers. We are using yellow and green bell peppers, a little combination for a little extra color. Very nice nutritional content when you mix up your bell peppers. Notice that you don't really even have to stir this. All you have to do is just move it around for everything nice and easy. We're going to give that just a couple of seconds. Now, once again, to make things very easy for us to do, all of our seasonings are combined and measured and ready to rock and roll. Everything is pre-portioned as you see it and ready to start this chili and finish this chili very, very quickly. This is a fast meal. Once you have everything portioned and laying out in front of you, you should be able to put this chili together in just a matter of a couple of minutes. Once it comes to a complete boil, you're done. It stores well in your refrigerator, just like all the chilies in this program. You'll be able to have a shelf life in your refrigerator of approximately 2 weeks if it's sealed well and your refrigerator is running at a proper temperature. Proper temperature for a refrigerator, 40 degrees or less. Best way to find out if your refrigerator is at the proper temperature is pretty easy. Take a thermometer, put it on the inside of your door. The inside of your door of your refrigerator is the warmest place in a refrigerator. If the warmest place of your refrigerator is the right temperature, everything else is the right temperature. Best way to check your refrigerator. Okay, we got our peppers and our celery going. A nice rate here. Now it's time to add our onions and caramelize our onions. And here we go. We always keep our work area clear and free of any extra debris. You don't want to work in a mess. You work in a mess, that's inefficient. If you go to factories that mass produce things, you'll see that they do not work in a messy area. It's always clean and organized so you get maximum production. Keep your counter clear of anything that you don't need. Onions are ready, and we're going to add our mushrooms. Mushrooms are a natural source of MSG. They are great for enhancing things. If you're making purees and soups, sauce reductions, a slice or two of mushroom will enhance all the rest of the flavors of anything it is that you're doing. Mushrooms are a great enhancer, nice background flavor. A real, real asset to anything that you're doing as far as your cooking goes in the kitchen. You'll see how quickly the mushrooms cook. Hello. Again, always have a clean towel, dry towel in your hands for not only cleanups, but also too taking care of hot pots. Make sure that you don't have any accidents in your kitchen. And also too, every kitchen should have a first aid kit in it. Make sure that your first aid kit is always stocked properly and make sure it's clean. Don't put the dirty wrappers back in there. The dirty wrappers go in the garbage can. Your first aid kit should be sterile and clean so that when you do need it, when an unfortunate circumstance occurs, when somebody gets hurt, it's there and ready to do the job for you. So two things in your kitchen you should always have, no matter what, a fire extinguisher and a first aid kit. Think safety first when you're cooking in the kitchen, and you're always going to have a good day. Now with these pans that I'm using, these are specially built. These are probably the finest pans on the planet. These are made by a company up in Wisconsin called Healthy Gourmet, made by a parent company called AmeriCraft. Excellent stuff. Surgical stainless steel. The sides are just as thick as the bottom. Inside layers of aluminum and iron. Conducts the heat evenly and distributes it evenly from the top of the pan all the way to the bottom, so you can cook on low heats without any problems at all. You can cook very, very quickly. You can see that this is already done and it's ready for the garlic. The garlic, once again, we add at the very end. This way, we get the maximum benefit out of it. The oil affects the garlic in a way that makes it nice and sweet for us. And we get the maximum flavor out of it. You don't want to boil your garlic. Garlic will get bitter on you. And we're ready for all the rest of the ingredients. Just like that. It only takes a few seconds. We're going to add our tomato juice and our tomato puree. We're going to add our diced tomatoes. We're going to add our corn. We're going to add our seasonings. We're going to give them a stir. And you'll see this darken up from all the seasonings that we just put in there. We really like our seasonings. And remember, once you get these recipes, if you want them spicier than what the recipe calls for at this point in time, feel free to add extra chili flakes to it. Maybe some black pepper, some cayenne pepper. Maybe you like ancho chilies. Maybe you want to put some asparagus spears in here cut up. Go for it. It's your recipe at this point in time. Customize it the way you want. Remember, it's your kitchen. Wherever your kitchen is, that's the right way to do it because it's your kitchen. Now the okra, we're gonna add dead last. And we're gonna look for our spatula. Here's our spatula. We're gonna remove our top. We're gonna add our tomato paste, which calls in this recipe for half a can, 3 ounces. Stir this in. Notice I'm not even using a whip for this because it's so nice and thick. It's got so much going for it. This is going to be a very, very rich, hearty chili when we get done with it. And in my world, chili has beans. I don't know who thought of chili without beans, but we need to talk to that person. So we're going to get out our red bean recipe once again, and we're going to dish in our beans. Make sure that we don't drip. Two. And three. And then we're all set. We're ready to rock and roll. And just like that, we have everything we need for our vegetables. Vegetable chili. Now, vegetarians, this is great stuff. You can use this inside of anything you want. You can put this inside of fajitas. You can serve this on top of rice. You can eat it straight up. You can do tortilla chips with it. Very, very versatile recipe. If you're not a strict vegetarian, dairy products, top it with cheese. You can even do something exotic like putting some nuts on it. It's really up to you and what you want to do with it. This will literally come to a simmer very, very quickly. And when it starts to simmer, we're going to add the okra at that point in time, and then we're going to call it a day. The okra, you've noticed here, we're using frozen okra. I am actually choosing frozen okra intentionally. Now, you can use fresh okra. That's not an issue. But if you use frozen okra, what happens is, during the freezing process, the starches in the okra bleed out. When the starches bleed out in the okra, it makes it easier for those starches to help thicken the chili. So that's why I have a tendency to go to a more consistent product, in this particular case, using frozen okra. You can see the nice bright green color that it's got from the freezing process, and you can see that it's got just a little bit of sticky film to it, which is perfect. And that's going to come out, and you can see that on the tips of my fingers. It's really, really good for the chilies, great for jambalaya. We're going to get to that jambalaya recipe real soon. Now you can see now that we've added the okra to the vegetable chili, this has got a nice hearty texture to it that even meat eaters will appreciate. So ladies, if you're a vegetarian and you want to do something that the guys are going to appreciate, but you still want to serve a vegetarian dish, you definitely want to serve something like this.